Welcome back to the channel. In today's video, we will be discussing how to check the resistance of timber joist to bending and shear stresses, and undertake a deflection check. A timber floor is to span 3.6 meters, and is supporting a characteristic imposed floor load of 2.5 kilonewtons square meter. The joists are placed at 600 millimeters spacing, and have timber boards fixed on top that have a self-weight of 0.15 kilonewtons per square meter. We need to find a suitable timber joist can support this load. These are common sizes of timber floor joists. We will check if a 225 mm by 63 mm C16 is ideal to carry the load. In the United Kingdom, softwood floor joists are typically sawn and graded in two strength classes, C16 and C24. C16 is the more common grade, but weaker class, making it easier and less expensive to obtain. C24 is a little stronger, but more expensive, and is typically used where geometry and depth of floor construction play a significant role in the structure's design. The material properties of C16 and C24 timber are given in the table below. To determine the size of the floor joists, we must first calculate our loading. Self-weight plus finishes equal joist depth, 0.225, times width, 0.063, times mean density 3.7 kilonewtons per meter cubed, plus timber board self-weight 0.15 kilonewtons per square meter, multiplied by joist spacing of 0.6 meters. This corresponds to a value of 0.09 kilonewtons per meter. The imposed load equals the characteristic imposed floor load of 2.5 kilonewtons per square meter, multiplied by 0.6 meters joist spacing. This gives a value of 1.5 kilonewtons per meter. We'll need both the ultimate limit state and the serviceability limit state to figure out the stresses and deflection. In the serviceability limit state, uniformly distributed load equals total unfacted loads, which equals dead load 0.09 kilonewtons per meter, plus imposed load 1.5 kilonewtons per meter. This gives a value of 1.6 kilonewtons per meter. Uniformly distributed load in ultimate limit state equals total facted loads, which equals dead load 1.35 times 0.09 kilonewtons per meter, plus imposed load 1.5 times 1.5 kilonewtons per meter. This results in a value of 2.4 kilonewtons per meter. We should now be able to calculate the applied design forces. The bending moment of a simply supported beam is equal to the design load of 2.4 kilonewtons per meter, multiplied by the span of 3.6 meters squared, divided by 8. This results in a value of 3.85 kilonewtons meter. The shear force for a simply supported beam is equal to the design load of 2.4 kilonewtons per meter, multiplied by the span of 3.6 meters, divided by 2. This gives us a value of 4.3 kilonewtons. The applied bending stress equals the design bending moment, divided by the elastic modulus of the joist, which is calculated as the width times the depth of the section squared, divided by 6, giving us a value of 532 times 10 to 3 millimeters cubed. To convert kilonewton meter to newton millimeter, the bending stress equals the design bending moment 3.85 times 10 to 6, divided by the elastic modulus 532 times 10 to 3. This results in a value of 7.23 newton per square millimeter. This value must be compared to joist strength. Timber is a hygroscopic material that absorbs and releases moisture depending on the amount of moisture in its surrounding environment. Because the strength and stiffness properties of timber are affected by moisture content, the environment around the timber must be considered. There are three types of services. The following are examples of typical environments and the corresponding service class. Service class 1. Intermediate floors, warm roofs, internal and party timber frame walls. Service class 2, ground floors, cold roofs, timber frame walls that are against the outer skin of cladding, and all other instances where the timber is protected from direct exposure to water. Service Class 3, External, Fully Exposed. The strength of a piece of timber is proportional to the duration of the load. The greater the duration of the load, the greater the strength of timber required to resist that load. To that end, a variety of factors are applied to the characteristic properties of the timber. The values for the factor KMOD, which is applied to the strength of the timber, and is based on the imposed load duration, are provided in the table below. The imposed floor load with the self-weight of the joists, and superimposed dead load is a typical critical condition for timber floor joists within a building. This load condition results in a value of KMOD of 0.8, because it is subject to an imposed load, which is defined as medium term, as well as self-weight. Design bending strength equals this formula. KH is modification factor. If a member is less than or equal to 150 mm deep, and has a material density of less than 7 kN per meter cubed, the factor is defined as or 1.3, whichever is the lesser. For all members that are greater than 150 mm deep, the value of KH is taken to be 1. This factor is applied to the bending capacity of the joist if the compression face of the floor joists is not restrained against bending-induced torsional rotation, which is a rare condition. In most cases, there is no risk of lateral torsional buckling affecting a floor joist. This is due to the presence of a floor finish that acts as a restraint on the joists. This load-sharing modification factor, which equals 1. Characteristic bending strength, which equals 16 Newton square millimeter for C16. The partial factor has a value of 1.3. Therefore, the design bending strength equals 1 times 0.8 times 16 divided by 1.3, which gives us a value of 9.85 Newton per square millimeter, which is greater than 7.32 Newton square millimeter. Furthermore, we must check the shear resistance of the joists. For a simply supported joist, the design maximum shear force is equal to the design reaction. In the case of timber, the maximum design shear stress, not average shear stress, needs to be checked against the design shear resistance. The maximum design shear stress of a rectangular section is calculated using 1.5 times the design applied shear force, divided by the depth and the width of the section. In order to take into account cracking within the timber, the width of the joist is reduced by factor of 0.67. As a result, applied shear stress equals 1.5 times the design applied shear force, multiplied by 4.3 times 1000 to convert to Newton, divided by joist depth 225 mm, divided by width 63 mm, multiplied by factor 0.67. This results in a value of 0.674 Newton per square millimeter. This formula equals the allowable shear stress. That is 0.8 times 1 times 3.2, divided by 1.3. This gives us a value of 2 Newton per square millimeter, which is greater than the value of 0.674 Newton per square millimeter. Finally, we must to undertake deflection check. The moment of inertia of the section equals width 63 mm times depth 225 to 3 divided by 12. This gives us a value of 59.8 times 10 to 6 mm to 4. Deformation factor for service class 2 equals 0.8. C16 has a parallel mean modulus of elasticity of 8,000 Newton per square millimeter. So first, we need to work out deflection due to dead loads including creep, which equals 5 times dead load, 0.09 kilonewton per meter, times joist span 3,600 to 4, divided by 384, divided by parallel mean modulus of elasticity 8,000, divided by moment of inertia 59.8 times 10 to 6 times 1 plus deformation factor 0.8. This gives us a value of 0.74 millimeters. Next, the deflection due to imposed loads including creep equals 5 times imposed load, 1.5 kN per meter, times joist span 3600 to 4, divided by 384, divided by parallel mean modulus of elasticity 8000, divided by moment of inertia 59.8, times 10 to 6, times 1 plus deformation factor 0.8, times 0.3. This gives us a value of 8.5 millimeters. The sum of these deflections provides the overall deflection due to bending. However, there is the issue of deflection due to shear. This is rarely a critical condition, but it is prudent to add 10% to the overall deflection to arrive at a final value to allow for it. Therefore, total deflection including shear equals 10.2 millimeters. The allowable deflection equals joist span divided by 250, which is 14.4 millimeters, is greater than total deflection 10.2 millimeters. As a result, the 225 millimeters by 63 millimeters C16 timber joist is deemed satisfactory. Thanks for watching. We hope you found some useful tips. Check out our website at structuralengineercalcs.com. Please like and subscribe, and let us know what would you like to see next. The human footprint is a masterpiece of engineering and a work of art. Stay safe. Goodbye, and see you soon.